Hello, malty misanthrope, and thank you to Sparkinson's for that malt mention. The malt mention introduces a whisky review here at Ralphie.com. I'm Ralphie, providing the dot communists, and welcome to the Manx Bothy, somewhere in the Irish Sea. The other side of the Irish Sea is Ireland. That's where this whisky comes from. It's called Glendalough. Now, in Scotland, it would be Glendalough. And that's the way the Scots would pronounce it. But in Ireland, you see, Ireland's a separate country, you see. So in Ireland, it's pronounced Glendalough. It's kind of softer, more lilting and all the rest of it. And it's rather tasty. I'm going to share it with you. The nose, the taste, the malt mark, well, the blend mark in this instance. And then talk a little bit more about Glendalough. This particular example of the from bottled by this distillery, I'll come to that shortly, and not produced by them, I'll come to that shortly. This is the double barrel Irish whisky bottled at 42%. Okie dokie, the double barrel meaning that basically it spent most of its time, 3.5 years roughly, maturing in ex-bourbon casks and then finished off for 6 months in an ex-Oloroso cask, just to give it that little bit extra. 6 months isn't a long time, but particularly in a younger whisky, it can make a difference depending on the calibre of the casks. Let's nose it, smell it, taste it, and then make our mind up. I'm liking that nose already because it's not Scotch whisky, most definitely not. It's far more camphorish, slightly minty. There is a certain grapefruit oil in the nose. It's sharper. It's quite astringent, but richly flavoured with it. And that richness of flavour is coming from the particular grain that was used to make this whisky, which is corn. In my opinion, the finest corn whisky in the world comes from Ireland. But what do I know? I'm just a commentator. I'm not an expert. Interestingly, this is touted as a single grain whisky in some places, but in fact, I've also read while I was doing my research that there's more than one grain involved. It's 90% corn, 10% malted barley. Now, I don't know if this is true because there isn't that degree of transparency readily available. But it's certainly got that corn characteristic, which is so readily identifiable with Cooley Distillery. So I think it's only fair to point out to your malt mates that when you see this bottle, and it certainly appears as if it's their own whisky, it is in fact they're acting as independent bottlers. This is not whisky made, produced in the stills at Glendalough Distillery. It's from Cooley Distillery, so in fact they're acting as independent bottlers of Cooley. And I think a little bit of transparency would be good on the label, because the label's where it matters. They could just say sourced from Cooley Distillery. There's no shame in that, because Cooley is in fact the most interesting distillery in Ireland in 100 years. That's the way it's evolving from the what we have access to smell and taste from the Cooley range, and goodness knows Cooley produced some brilliant corn whiskey, really did, and all by accident. But the nose is opening up slightly. I'm going to add a spot of water. Not quite sure why they bottled it at 42%. I certainly wouldn't. You'd bottle either 43 or 46. There we go. Not much, just a little. Glendalough advertise themselves as Ireland's first craft distillery. But frankly, I'm hearing it, but I'm not seeing it. When I see it, I'll see unchill filtered, natural colour, I'll see it bottled at a consistently higher strength, and it'll be excellent marketing. But until then, let's concentrate in the nose here, because it's really starting to open up that natural spirit-driven complexity. Fascinating, different, engaging, and very well made. Soft banana, some spearmint, mild mint, a variety of mints, wintergreen, lemongrass, most definitely some beautiful lemongrass going on there. Mild, almost confectionery ginger note, as in ginger rock that you would get from Edinburgh rock, that soft, crumbly rock. Delightful Muscovado sherry note. It's working quite well. This Oloroso cask that they used, well, definitely a sweet one, but not imposing too much. And some almond marzipan in here. Just suddenly hit me, that nuttiness. Almond marzipan, soft, unbleached marzipan. Touch of lemon oil now. Vanilla, most certainly. Complex, different. I know I'm repeating myself, but it's worth repeating. This is a fantastic, original and truly authentic Irish nose, which should make the nation of Ireland very proud indeed. If you want an experienced international currency, well, the nose in this whisky is a pretty good place to start. The taste, how about that then? Quite a bit of bite to the arrival, a long arrival, slightly astringent. In the development, some bitterness appears. You don't think there's going to be much of a development after such a prolonged arrival, but there is. It sustains itself. It just goes on and on. It gets slightly sour, but it's a rich, grain, complex sour note. Well balanced, beautifully substantial. And in the finish, well, we get a little bit of return of the vanilla and something crisp. A sort of, again, that confectionery note, but sour confectionery. Sour boiling sweet. I don't know if you're ever in the British Isles, there's a confectionery called Sour Plums. Sour plums, right. Well, you've got that sour plum note. It's quite elusive to begin with when you're tasting this whiskey, but it tends to grow. It becomes more prominent after a while as the separate flavour components of this whiskey start to come together and deliver the kind of overlaid experience on the tongue. Another taste, just to check, it's got to be done. Now starting to notice toasted almond, marzipan, sugared almonds. Yeah, noticing that as well. A distinctive marzipan, bitter marzipan note. A hint, slight hint of chilli, and a real touch, just a background note of pickled ginger, as you would find in a Chinese supermarket. Go look for it, malt mates. Chinese supermarkets are very interesting places, wherever you may be. And fantastic. I'm going to add a drop more water before I finally deliver my marks on this. For such a young whisky, by Scotch whisky standards, and bear in mind, Irish whisky tends to work well young. Just look at Paddy's and Powers. They tend to be kind of laughed off a bit by even Irish whisky connoisseurs, but they're delicious, substantial, earthy, honest whiskies, both of them. And I see a little bit of that legacy in this corn whisky from Cooley. It's just one of the finest moments. And it's the reason when it came to reviewing a Glendalough whisky, I could have gone for the 7-year-old or the 13-year-old. I could have got myself on a bottle of a variety of Puccini's and gins as well. Gins well worth looking out for. They're very nicely put together. But there again, when you're using Holstein skills stills, it's easy to make good gin. I'll come to this shortly. But back to this corn whisky, it's well worth the effort. It's something that's different. For those who've never encountered it before, it gives you a bigger surprise, a delightful surprise, as tasting a nice smoky mezcal for the first time. That's the sort of individuality and characteristics that you will find in an Irish corn whisky. Now, wouldn't it be interesting to find a corn whisky which was pure pot still, you know, mashed and unmashed corn? Not quite sure how that would work, but it sounds interesting. But I tell you what would be fascinating would be peated corn whisky. Oh my goodness, is that doable? Of course it is. I'm sure Ireland could do it. The taste is becoming fuller. It's becoming sharper. Fresh. Astringent. More challenging. More engaging, it's more demanding, but it's also that rewarding side to it. Well, this is one of these whiskies you could just keep adding water and the power in it continues to grow. Fascinating stuff. I could bump on a little bit more about this. It is really one of the nicest Cooley corn whiskies that I've ever tasted. And it wasn't an outrageous price either, as far as I'm concerned. What would have helped if it had been bottled at 43% or 46% ideally? But for the distillers, there's big tax implications. And goodness knows duty is harsh enough from the producers. But if you're going to use the term craft distillery, you really want to be looking at consistent bottling at 46%. And that's an opinion. If you want to be the best there can be, right? You've got to exceed the best that already is. Bit of philosophy there, mock mates. Just sharing. 88. Here we are. Out of 100. And that, I'm going to call it a blend mark. I'm not going to call it a corn mark because I suspect that there is 10% malted barley. I don't know for sure. But if it was on the label, I would know for sure where it matters, because that is the contract, the direct contract between the producer and the customer. That's where it really, really matters. And you can always tell a proper craft distillery because they are marketing flannel light and they are integrity heavy. Glendalough. If you go to Dublin, across the Irish Sea, drink some of their cask ale and whisky and as merry as you can be. You will find your way down south to the Wicklow Mountains. Yes, they're lovely, green, generally wet places, loaded with pre-medieval monastic history. And there's a particularly charming chapel down there with a nice rustic tower outside that Rapunzel would be proud to be locked up in by the looks of it. And there is the basically what's left of St. Kevin. St. Kevin was one of the fine traditions of Celtic saints, in other words, pre-Catholic, Gnostic Christian, early Celtic Christian church saints, who was big on reclusiveness and examining the world in isolation and basically discovering knowledge. That was a golden age of religious focus was the early Middle Ages, the Dark Ages, as they sometimes call it, although it wasn't quite as dark as they make out. And there was St. Kevin communing with nature between two lovely lakes, and there he built his chapel and did some wonderful deeds. And that's St. Kevin there. You know, with his hands aloft, you know, sort of engaging with the heavens and a bird in his hand, because birds fly away to heaven like doves and things. Well, you know, that's the way it is. And so, understandable. I mean, a great location for a distillery, to be honest, because you've got that elevation. You've got plenty of water, no shortage of water in Ireland, very good quality water as well, by the way, and a shortage of genuine craft distilleries. So in 2000, well, it's in fact this year, 2015, that really this distillery started producing. Interesting, if you go to their website, it's nice and fairly direct, simple, amenable and communicative. But what I do notice, first thing I notice, is these beautiful, shiny, highly efficient German Holstein stills. Oh my goodness. Everywhere you go, small distilleries, instead of using old-fashioned pot stills and the cost of them and the temperamental nature of them, are using shiny, very controllable, easily manipulable Holstein stills with all the lovely brushed circles and the metalwork that sparkle so nicely once you've polished it up with the spray can and the buffer. Oh, they look lovely. Holstein stills are great for making gin, great for making vodka, and they can make some pretty good rye. However, they tend to sanitise the production of grain whisky, in my opinion, particularly barley, which is a sensitive, subtle grain. It's delicate. It, you know, if you want to get flavour out of barley, you need a big kiss-kick-ass fat pot still. And Glendalough, as far as I'm aware, no proof, don't have one of those yet. So if I was a craft distillery in Ireland, what I would be doing is I would be having loads of transparency in the label, because transparency is absolutely brilliant marketing in a whole genre where marketing can be notoriously fake, right-o? So integrity marketing, you just can't go wrong. Also, to have a traditional, authentic heritage still which needs a bit more cleaning, which needs more work, which isn't quite as finishing, as finish friendly on production, but at the same time it can produce some singular individual characteristic flavour that you won't find anywhere else. That's one reason why Scotch single malt whiskies have been so successful around the world. Fat old warts and all, pot stills. And if you're a craft distillery anywhere in the world, not just in Ireland, and if you want to be producing, if you want to be investing in the future, you're investing in the singularity. Not forget smooth, forget accessible. It's singular, definitive, complex, ambiguous, at times challenging, even at times very demanding spirit. And it's knowing what kind of casks you need and the calibre of casks to really make the best of that spirit, to get the distance. Knowing, of course, that in the long term, the longer your spirit ages in your sealed oak casks, my goodness, the more you're stocking up for the future. But there we go. A little passing opinion from me, Ralphie, seeing as I've, you know, spent a lot of time over the years around distilleries and stills and people that have worked in distilleries, and particularly coopers and actually people who actually operate stills. These are the most interesting people every single time. There we go. I'm Ralphie. This was an Irish review, an Irish whiskey review. So you get the E in the whiskey. It's a clue there, you see. Now I'm being facetious. I apologise, malt mates. I'm just in that one of that slightly flippant mood that happens. In fact, Glendalough, if you ever get to Glendalough, about to call it Glendalough again, you will not see many leprechauns. All right, now, I'm just telling you so as you know. There used to be loads around there, but they get that fed up being photographed and pestered, and people trying to talk crake to them, that a lot of them actually got the boats out and sailed over here to the Isle of Man, where I am, because it's a lot quieter, it's a lot more peaceful. And the first I knew about it was when some of my whiskey went missing, because there's one thing that leprechauns really, really like is whiskey. Sure, they'll go for rum if they're stuck. Cognac, they think is pretentious. They've got no time for champagne. It's either beer or whiskey. That's it with the leprechauns. There's no middle distance. You know, you've got to respect them. They know their mind. So, I mean, I have had a bit of bother with them, but I think we've come to an agreement. Occasionally, I'll kind of just nip down the glen a wee bit and just kind of do a little bit of quality control on their own production that they're doing, strictly for themselves, you understand. Not for sale to humans, because humans can't cope with leprechaun brew. It just cannot cope. It's absolute fire water to humans, even though it tastes divinely delicious. But there we go. I'm Ralphie. That was another whiskey review. It was an Irish whiskey review. And when you come back for whiskey review 661, because this is whiskey review 660, well, it'll be another Irish whisky review. Powers pot still. That's what it'll be. But before you go, just to let you know, I've started a Patreon page. Now, just check it out if you're interested. It is entirely, completely, totally optional. That's all it is. But I've put down in my description box a link to my Patreon page for your perusal. If it appeals to you, go for it. Next year, depending on the success, I'll probably be having basically little kind of prize draws to attach to it and post stuff out to people, you know, sign books and monogrammed glasses and stuff like that. But anyway, anywho, that'll do for now. I'm Ralphie. Bless you lots. And remember, maltmates, one more thing, one final passing word of wisdom, about five words of wisdom. Keep it quality, not quantity.